Living in northern Ghana is what made climate change real to me. I could see desertification happening in the 2.5 years I lived there. And I experienced firsthand energy inequity. The northern part of Ghana is much poorer and more rural than the south. The capital of Ghana, Accra, got electricity in 1965. My town, Tumu, was connected to the grid in 1994, about a year and a half into my time there. Seeing the effect of climate change and energy inequity on the people I lived with is one of the reasons I went on to study ways to slow down the human impact on climate. We have to address climate change, and we have to do it in a way that works for marginalized communities. The current energy system is inequitable, not just overseas, but here in the US. The energy system is racist. Pollution from fossil fuels is much worse in low-income areas, and worse still in communities of color, even accounting for income and wealth. Look at Jersey City, home of the highly polluting Hudson Power Plant, which was finally closed in 2017. The people that live near the plant are exposed to the pollution and the toxics. They have an average income that's about the same as the whole city. But they are 75% people of color, compared to 50% for the city and 33% for the whole state. This kind of siting is pernicious. The energy system is regressive. Low-income people pay huge amount of their paychecks for energy bills. In fact, they often pay more due to low-quality housing stock with low energy efficiency. Think about mobile homes. They house 17 million people with a median household income of $30,000. They pay twice as much per square foot as stick-built homes. COVID has made these inequities even worse. In a recent survey of people who are at twice the poverty line, so these are working class people, they found that 17% couldn't pay their energy bills, and 20% had to skip key household needs like food and medicine in order to do so. While this is bad, breaking down the data reveals it's even worse. 33% of Hispanic households and 20% of Black households couldn't pay their energy bills, compared to just 12% of white households. But we are facing a radical transformation of the energy system. In order to address climate change, we need to move to a system that's net zero carbon, and we need to do it pretty quickly. This is a massive challenge. It can be hard to get our heads around the scale of this. Imagine building a full-size 1 gigawatt nuclear power plant every single week. This would get us half the carbon-free energy we need by 2040. But building more generation is only part of the problem. We need to reimagine the electricity system so we can get power when we need it, like when we flip on a light switch. Many of the low-carbon options have challenges. Nuclear power has very little flexibility to turn on or off. Wind and solar work when the wind is blowing or the sun is shining. So building all this new generation and making it work for us means that the energy system of the future is going to look very different than today. The question is, will we move toward a system that is more just and equitable? When I lived in Ghana, I had a chance to travel around Africa, and I ended up on a canoeing trip on the Zambezi River in Zimbabwe. I'll always remember the guide's instructions to us. First, don't trail your hand in the water unless you want it bitten off by a crocodile. Second, beware of hippos. Now, you're too small to bother them, but they don't like the boats. So if you're facing an angry hippo, jump out of the boat and into the water to face the hungry crocodiles. Neither of these options seemed very good. Climate change and energy transition can feel like this sometime. We need to change our energy system, but no solution is perfect. Consider solar energy. Solar generates pollution-free energy just from sunlight. All right, how cool is that? Because of that, many states, including Massachusetts, provide subsidies to households to install solar. Every ratepayer in the state pays into this fund, but the subsidies don't go to everyone equally. They go to people who can afford the upfront costs, and maybe more importantly, they go to people who own roofs and who aren't in the shadow of urban buildings. These kind of policies increase the energy burden of the low income while benefiting the upper middle class and wealthy. It's a kind of reverse Robin Hood, taking from the poor and giving to the rich. So, I ask again, will we move toward a more just and equitable energy system? Not unless we're vigilant and intentional. Now, some of this is the technology. Solar needs a sunny place to sit. Some of it is policy and regulation, the rules that determine how our energy bills interact with solar. Now, there are some innovative approaches to righting wrongs like this. Blue Hub Capital, a community development financial institution, is coming up with ways for low-income urban dwellers to treat off-site solar as if it were on their roofs. And they're coming up with clever financing mechanisms that benefit the tenants at the same time as the wealthy investors. This is a great start, and it shows the value of innovative thinking. Consider pollution. Springfield, Massachusetts, which is just a few miles down the road from here, is about 70% Black or Hispanic and has 25% of the population living under the poverty line. Okay? It's been called the asthma capital of the United States. And yet, there's talk about siting a biomass plant here. Now, it's controversial whether this biomass plant will reduce greenhouse gas emissions or not. But it's very likely that biomass will play a role in our fight against climate change. So we need to think about where we site these plants. Is it fair to site this polluting plant in an area that's already racked by pollution? Or put another way, can we address climate change and help communities like Springfield at the same time? There may be technological solutions. There's some emerging technologies that can capture greenhouse gas emissions and all the other pollutants before they go up into the air. But adding technologies like this add a lot of cost, so questions need to be asked. When it comes to equity, we need to think, who asks and who answers? Whose questions get listened to? Usually, it's the entitled and the empowered. Politicians, bureaucrats, business owners, and people much like me, white, relatively wealthy. We feel entitled to ask questions. We can be squeaky wheels who don't get called angry every time they ask a leading question or question power. And whose answers get listened to? Experts, which is good. We need scientists and we need social scientists. We don't want to make decisions based on hunches or spin. But we often ignore some of our experts, those people who know the building, who know the community, who have on-the-ground experience. The Dakota Access Pipeline is an example where indigenous knowledge around stewardship of the land and water was ignored. My research has mostly been looking at energy technologies that can help us solve climate change. My motivation has always been social justice. It's clear that climate change is going to have the worst impacts on the poor and the marginalized. And climate change policy, if it's not smart, can hurt those same groups. But I was feeling that equity was not centered enough in my research. So along with some colleagues who were feeling the same way, we started the Energy Transition Institute at UMass Amherst. Our focus is stakeholder-engaged research and education at the intersection of energy technology and social equity. We've been experimenting with community-engaged co-design of energy solutions. Community-engaged co-design is a concept that's been used by planners recently to plan infrastructure. But applying it to the energy system adds layers of complexity, because the energy system, and especially the electricity system, is very complicated. For example, when California restructured their electricity system in the early 2000s, the economists and politicians didn't talk to the engineers, and they had some pretty serious errors about how the electricity system works. That led to rolling blackouts and price spikes of $1,400 for what should have been $45. The challenge we face now is even greater than what California faced then. We are speeding to develop all kinds of new technologies to address climate change, and we're restructuring our electricity system so we can incorporate those technologies. One thing is clear: it's not enough to develop cool, new, cutting-edge technologies. There's no reason to think they will make things more equitable. And it's not enough to develop policies and regulations around today's technologies and today's energy system. We know the system is going to look different in the future. We must innovate at the intersection of energy technology and policy, and do it with the full involvement of the marginalized communities who are most affected. So back on the Zambezi River, after spending the first half of the day partnered with the guide, I had to switch canoes and partner with a mere mortal. And sure enough, we ended up facing an angry hippo with the current taking us right toward it. Now, my partner and I were not very coordinated, and we were very tired by that time of the trip. But instead of jumping in the water and taking our chances with the crocodile, we managed to focus, work together, and paddle out of harm's way. This is the challenge that climate change and energy transition leave us. In order to avoid the angry hippo, we must work together, use all of our skills, and listen to all of our people to find ways to work toward a cleaner and more just energy system.